Hello and welcome. This is Jim Huntoon for the Carolinas Golf Course Superintendents Association member profile. We're here today with Mr. Michael Bankert.
Happy to be here, Jim.
Thank you for doing this. This is the Legends Golf Resort, 54-hole facility here in Myrtle Beach. Mike's the director of agronomy, and let's just start off talking about this facility, Mike.
So I came here in January of 16, three golf courses. One was a Tom Doak design. It opened in 1990. The other was the Moreland PB Dye. It was 1990 as well. And then they had the Parkland open 2 years later. The architect of that's a little in question. I think Larry Young was most involved in that one. Three different golf courses, really good courses.
When I think about the Parkland, you know, I know it was started by Tom Doak, and he was assisted at the time by Gil Hans, and then Mike Stramps was involved, Larry Young, Danny Young, and now recently you did a renovation over there, redid the bunkers, changed a lot of the bunkers, made it more golfer friendly, and you know, that's quite the list of provenance on the architecture with your name on there, Mike. How does that make you feel?
I actually love it. I'm a Parkland lover. I came over here, and the Parkland to me seemed like it was the one that needed the most love. So we were lucky enough to go in, and Scott Laughlin and Motten Golf, they had relationships with Century, so they came in, and we just started on number one and put our heads together and tried to come up with a plan where the bunkers wouldn't wash, but it was visually appealing, you know. So I think we eliminated a third of the bunkers. They were really, really deep, hard to maintain bunkers. So we just started on one and went through about 6 acres of sod. Took us all summer. We had golfers out there while we were doing it, but it turned out really well, really well.
It did, and it was a nice improvement. You know, tell the people a little bit about the volume of play that you do out here on these golf courses.
Yeah, so we run, I think this year we had about 185,000 rounds. We have a 25-acre driving range, about 1,200 driving range members. They're just very busy golf courses. So our maintenance, in the summertime, we're here at 4:30, starting to mow fairways, trying to stay ahead of play. If we ever get caught, you know, that's our day's kind of done. We don't get much done after that.
Yeah, efficiency is everything in an operation like this.
It is. And we don't, we're running four fairway mowers right now. So, you know, we really got to get out there early, get everything done, and try to move on.
So take us back to how you got in the golf business. I know you very well. You're a very frequent golf partner of myself, and I know you love golf. And kind of talk about your starts in the game and kind of what motivated you to get into turf management.
That's a pretty long story, Jim.
But keep it short for the people, please.
All right, I will. So I came down in 1990 to go to Coastal Carolina. I wanted to walk on the golf team. It didn't work out for me. I stayed down a couple years, and my father was like, this isn't working, son. I wasn't mature enough to be down here by myself, so I moved back home, went to the University of Delaware, got into a little club in Elkton, Maryland, as an assistant pro, and did that, but man, I couldn't deal with the customers, Jim. They were tough. But I wanted to be in golf, and I knew about Ori Tech, so I came down in 1996 and was lucky enough to get on at Myrtlewood, and the rest is history after that. Just kind of got lucky my whole way through.
That's a great segue into, you've been at Myrtlewood in your career, 36-hole facility here in Myrtle Beach. You did a long stint as director of agronomy at Myrtle Beach National, now here at the Legends. So you've really had a pattern of being at multi-course facilities throughout your career. I know you spent time as a regional superintendent over 6 or 7 golf courses, including your own. So what do you think about... what is it about you that's made you successful over the years at multi-course facilities?
I think my start in the business was at multi-course. So I was used to that. And I got in with with a good superintendent, and my first superintendent's job was actually an 18-hole South Creek, 18 holes at the little golf course, 85 acres, but it was fun to maintain, just a lot of fun. And then after that, I was lucky enough to move up to the King's North and then get all three at National. And it just seems like if you don't dwell on the stuff you can't control, then multi-course facilities is fine. Yep. You know, we don't do the same agronomic plan on all the golf courses. They're not the same, but the general principles are the same. And it's people. You know, we try to get the right people in the position. And if you can have good people underneath of you, which I've been lucky to have everywhere I've been, either students that have come up underneath of me that have been able to be superintendents for us, I've just been lucky with really good people. So multi-course for me has been kind of the same thing as an 18-hole for you.
Yep, it's always been normal to you. That's what you've always done.
Second nature. The regional position that I was in, now that was a little more frustrating because I couldn't concentrate on my own facility. And you know how it is when you're away from your own place. It gets difficult. But again, they had superintendents at all these clubs, and they were all good guys and good superintendents. So that made it a ton easier. And my job really was to just make sure the paperwork was done for those guys. And a second set of eyeballs. And everybody, as long as you try not to step on anybody's feet, everybody loves a second set of eyeballs out there.
And definitely a way that it helped you grow as a superintendent and a turf manager, being on all those different properties, seeing the uniqueness, and certainly something that has helped you over the years.
I would agree. And what's helped me out more than anything is the different agronomics that all of these superintendents have, right? So I never went into a place and said that it's going to be my way or the highway. We have to do it this way. I always tried to learn to what they were doing, what they were looking at, and it helps a ton to be able to see a ton of different guys growing grass all different ways and producing the same great product.
It does. I know I've benefited from your knowledge in that regard, being a colleague of yours for the last 5 years or whatever. It's you've brought a lot of that to my attention, and it's helped me too, so thank you for
that.
I
appreciate that.
And so let's talk about mentors and mentoring others. You try to downplay this, but you have mentored an incredible amount of superintendents over the years, especially for your age. You know, as long as you've done this, there's a lot of guys in your tree, and you've enjoyed that over the years, haven't you?
I have. Yeah. I have. It's it's always great to see one of your guys move up and get a super's job that he really likes and enjoy the business. And I think that's, if there's nothing else I've done, I've tried to make these guys understand that it's a fun job, man. Yep. This is fun. And if you enjoy it, if you like your job, then you're going to be very successful at it. So there's been a lot. There has been a lot. And for me, I always feel like I've benefited more from those guys than they've benefited from me, because my career has been, what I'm going to say, is very successful. But it's not necessarily me that's making it successful. It's everybody underneath of me that's just bringing everything up. It's been encouraging. My father taught me at a really young age, don't miss work. Go to work.
Yep.
Get there every single day. And if you get to work every day and you work hard, then good things are going to happen. So I try to do that, and it's been a good road so far.
Yeah, you can never underestimate the importance of being around.
Mm-hmm.
And when you do what we do, for sure.
That's
and,
right.
Who are some of your superintendent mentors over the years, some of the people that have helped shape you into the superintendent that you are today?
Well, the first guy that started my career, really, Max Morgan.
Yep.
He's been super influential in my career.
Yep.
He gave me my first shot, and he gave me my first shot as a multi-course superintendent. I was very fortunate at Myrtle Beach National. That place is such a great club, and it's right across the street from Horry Tech. So we were able to have all these students come in our door nonstop, and we had bent grass on all three, so we could teach the kids bent grass. We could teach them, you know, the value of staying late, working hard. So Max was, he was very, very good to me early on, and gave me opportunities. Now, I'm not going to say he gave me everything. I would say I've earned a lot of that, but he was definitely a very good start. And Max is addicted to golf.
He
is. You know that. So
yes, I do.
He is a golfer at heart. And at Myrtlewood, when I started, he would have employee golf days every once a week. We'd go out there and play, and we took that to Myrtle Beach National, and that's just awesome. You know, the morale of the crew, when you have something to look forward to every single week, you know, it's just amazing. So that was great. I've been fortunate enough to work with you over the years. You've been very helpful to my career, for one, but also just knowledge base. You know, it's good to be able to see different personalities, right, and understand how they are successful, and that's been really good. Really enjoyed that. I've had a couple really good guys underneath of me. Brett Whitson, he's just a worker, man. He works so hard mm-hmm. at everything he does, and that's motivation. You know, he's been great. David Hughes, he's probably one of the most underestimated superintendents we have here at the beach.
Yep.
He's just steady. He always produces a good product, no matter where he's at. So there's been just a lot of guys, Jim.
Yeah, and I was going to ask you, you know, kind of what advice would you give up-and-coming turf managers, but you've really answered that question several times in the dialogue we've already had. You know, it's
right.
about it's, being a people person, right? Mm-hmm. About being hardworking and, you know, being present and like your father said, coming to work. And what's always impressed me about you is you take everything in stride. You rarely get rattled. I've rattled you a few times.
That's right.
But
that's right.
In general, you don't get rattled. And,
yeah, so,
you know, our boss, Larry Woodbury, who's upstairs here, you know, when I told him we were doing this, he said, "You're the most low blood pressure guy he's ever been around." that's a big time compliment, Michael.
Yeah, I would say so. I would say in the shadows, if you were some of my guys, every once in a while, you'll feel the wrath. Tourette's rage might be coming out on you, but generally, I'll go back and apologize after that. To me, it's grass, and it's our job to grow it. And sometimes we make mistakes. Sometimes our students make mistakes. As long as it's not a mistake from not caring, then it's okay. You know, we'll get through it. We've been. I've killed an awful lot of grass and been able to come through on the other side and grow it back in. You know, we all have. So I try not to sweat the small stuff. As I get older, it's getting harder and harder to do that. But I don't know. I think if you're a student coming in, if you're wanting to get into the business, for me, you just have to work harder than everybody else on the crew. Separate yourself by working hard. That's it. And if you can do that, then it's obvious that you're learning how to mow, you're learning how to set up, you're learning how to top dress, you're learning how to spray, you're understanding. If you're there, just be there all the time. Separate yourself.
That's good advice. That's good advice. And obviously we've talked about your love of golf. What are some of the other things that that you like to do when you're away from the golf course?
So I have a wonderful family, Jim. A 7-year-old daughter, she just turned 7. Her name's Natalie. She's been a real treat. My wife, Brooke, she's been my rock. You know, she's steady for me. So we hang out a lot as a family. I love to cook. On the weekends, you know, we'll just start cooking and hanging out and enjoying each other's company. I like to go to the pool. I like to fish a little bit. But more than anything, it's just hanging out with them and doing what they like to do.
Yep. You are definitely a committed family man. And when I think about you, it's definitely family man and a lover of the game of golf.
I do. I love to play. Max has these every Saturday golf events, and I love to get in those. You know, those are fun days. And I don't get to play as much as I used to. You know, I used to like to come out twice a week, but it's kind of changed a little bit. My wife, I've always been one of the big family, right? And my wife was a little nervous about family. She didn't know if she wanted children. So there was a time where I said, look, if I turn 40, then I kind of want to start concentrating on retirement and not worry about the children. So if you don't get to that point, that's fine. On my 40th birthday, she took me out and told me she was pregnant. It was so crazy. And had no idea that we were even trying.
Yep.
No clue we were trying. It was really neat.
I feel like I know you pretty well, and I've never heard that story.
Yeah.
That's a good one.
Yeah.
So the last thing that I wanted to talk to you about real quick is just just your service over the years to the Palmetto Golf Course Superintendents Association, and you know, you've been a rock for that association, president several times, and just a behind the scenes type of guy. What do you enjoy about that?
So most of all, I enjoy the camaraderie of the association, right? I enjoy the events. I really enjoy getting out with my fellow super and talking turf, or just going out there and having a good time and relaxing and playing golf, right? So for me, I always feel like if you enjoy an association that much, well then it's your obligation to get involved eventually, right? Get involved and run it a little bit and take your turn. You know, everybody's got to take a turn if you want the thing to keep moving.
Absolutely.
So the Palmettos is a local association, so it doesn't have a huge membership. There might be 100 guys, but I feel like for me, I enjoy the event so much that I want the association to keep running and to stay strong and to keep going. So I feel like every once in a while, I need to step in, help them out. There's a lot of guys on the association that try hard and that do their best, but it's hard when you come on the board and you're a board member for a year or two, and then you're thrust into an executive board spot. You don't understand all of the association details, and so that's when I kind of jump in and just try to help them out and make them understand what the association is about.
Well, you're a good leader for sure in a lot of different ways, and that comes out. I've served with you on the board, and you know, you're the type of leader that will step up at any time, and I really appreciate that you do that. So thank you.
On
behalf of all of us on the Palmettos, thank you for everything you've done.
Yeah, appreciate that. Thank you, Chad.
Well, that's all I've got. Do you have anything else you want to say to the people, Mike?
No. I think we pretty much covered it all, Jim.
We have. Thank you, sir.
Yes, sir.
Mike, this decal on your ride here, our cameraman here, Mr. Alan Knight, said it reminded him of a World War II bomber going into Iwo Jima or something. Explain to the people what exactly this is.
Yeah, that's right. Golfers stop me all the time about this. What's up with the fluorescent orange sharks by all the ponds? Are you trying to keep the gators away? And actually, no. It's a company called Goosebusters. It's to keep the geese away, the Canadian geese. So they are scared to death of this image. He has a remote control machine that runs on land and water, and whenever a flock's exposed to his machine, they fly off the golf course. And I've never seen that. I was skeptical. All we had to do was drive with his decoy in my hand, and the flock of geese would fly away, Jim. So I decided to get with my buddy Mike Huff, and he made me a couple. I put it on the cart. Cart works just as good as a decoy on the golf course.
Really? So I didn't know that. So this isn't even part of the standard Goosebusters plan. This is a little Mike Bankert addition.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. Because I would have to take his decoy and chase the geese with his decoy. They wouldn't fly away from my golf cart. They had to see this particular thing.
Sure.
So I talked to Jack, and he was like, yeah, no problem. Make as many as you want. So it really works well. We don't have any out here. Whenever we do get a flock, he comes out. During that last storm we had, I came out to check on the golf course. It's just pouring and it's windy, and he's on the driving range with his machine chasing the geese off of there in a downpour. I mean, it is pouring. This guy is dedicated. He does a great job.
Goosebusters, a humane way to eradicate geese on your golf course.
That is correct. I love it.